So we had said that there are two systematic ways to explore a graph, and we earlier looked at breadth-first search, which explores a graph level by level using a queue to maintain the unexplored vertices as we go along. The other strategy that we use is called depth-first search. So in depth-first search, we start from a vertex I and we pick any one of its neighbors that has not been explored. In breadth-first search, we pick all its neighbors and put them into a queue. Here we pick any unexplored neighbor j. And now what we do is we basically suspend the exploration of I and start exploring j instead, right? So then we look at j, we look at the neighbor of j, we pick again some neighbor of j which has not been explored. We suspend j and go to the next vertex, and we keep doing this until we run out of vertices that we can reach down this path, right? And now when I reach a vertex through this process which I cannot explore any further, I come back along the path I have taken and find the first point where there was another choice for an unexplored. So you backtrack to the nearest suspended vertex that still has an unexplored neighbor. And then you explore that neighbor and so on, right? So here, unlike in breadth first search where we had to keep track of this vertices which had been visited level by level and then put them into a queue, and then we process this queue in this first in, first out manner. So the queue, the vertices which are added at level 1 get processed before the ones at level 2, and they get processed before the ones at level 3 and so on. In a depth first search, if I have walked down some distance, then I will come back to the point where I last stopped and see if there was something else I could do from there, and then I will walk back and so on. So I need not a first in, first out, but what is called a last in, first out. So the last vertex I suspended is the first that I restore and check again. So this is called a stack, right? So these are two very fundamental ways of organizing sequences. A queue is a first in, first out structure, and that's used in breadth first search. And a stack, as we will see, is used in this depth first search. So let's try to explore this depth first search. So for this, our stack will again, like our queue grew from left to right, our stack will again grow from left to right. So when I add things to the stack, I'll put it to the right. And now, unlike a queue, when I remove things from the stack, I will remove it from the right, not from the left. Remember, in the queue, we had a head here, right, and we had a tail here. So we put things here and we brought them out here. Instead, here I'm going to grow the stack this way and also remove it from this end, okay? So that's going to be our strategy. So for a change, instead of 7, let's suppose we start our depth first search from vertex 4, right? So we first start as before by marking 4 as visited. And now we have to pick a neighbor of 4 and suspend 4 and start exploring that neighbor instead. So the neighbors of 4 are 0, 3 and 7. So we can pick any one of them. So let's pick the smallest one, right? So I suspend 4 and I start exploring 0 instead. So now I look at the neighbors of 0 and explore them if they have not been visited. So notice that now visited is true for 0 and 4. And the stack has 4 in it. But now I'm going to suspend 0 and pick up one of its unexplored neighbors, say 1, right? So now I have marked 1 and 4. And so the stack is growing from left to right, remember. So 0 has come on top of 4 in the stack. So now I have to explore 1. So I explore 1 and I find it has only one neighbor which is unexplored, namely 2. So I suspend 1 and I start exploring 2. Now when I look at 2, 2 has no neighbors left to explore because it has only 2 neighbors, 0 and 1, both of which have already been visited. So I start moving back. So I backtrack from 2 to the most recently visited one, which was 1, and see whether 1 has anything more to be done. But 1 has nothing more to be done because 1 had only 2 neighbors, I visited both of them. So I backtrack to the previous one, which is 0. So I ask whether 0 has anything more to be done. So notice that from 0 I visited 1 and from 1 I visited 2. So though when I started with 0 I had not seen 2 yet, by the time I've come back to 0 through backtracking, 2 has already been visited. So at the current state of 0, it has no unvisited neighbors. So 4 was visited before it came to 0, 1 was visited from 0, and 2 was indirectly visited from 1 and therefore is no longer available. So I have to backtrack from 0 as well, right? So I backtrack from 0 back to 4. And now I ask whether 4 has anything interesting to say, right? And 4 says, yes, I have another vertex to visit, which is 3, right? So I explore this 3 and I suspend the 4, right? So now I finished this whole section and I've come here. So now from 3, I have two neighbors, 5 and 6, and so I suspend 3 and maybe I explore 5. And then from 5, I have two unexplored neighbors, 6 and 7. So maybe I suspend 5 and I explore 6. So now when I come to this point, I have 4 which triggered 3, which triggered 5, which triggered 6. So I have 4, 3 and 5 on the stack. And 6 has no new neighbors to explore because both 3 and 5 are already visited. So I will backtrack from 6 to the previous one, which is 5, and ask whether 5 has anything more to do. Well, 5 does. It has 7 and 8, right? So I will perhaps pick 7. So I will again suspend 5. This is a new suspension of 5. Okay, first time I suspended it because I've explored 6. Then I came back to 5 and I've suspended it again to explore 7. 7 has a neighbor 8, so I will suspend 7 and explore 8. 8 has a neighbor 9, so I will suspend 8 and explore 9. And at this point, if you look at the visited matrix, everything, this list, everything here has been marked true. Okay? But I still have this long queue of a long stack of things which I have suspended, so I have to make sure that nothing is missed out. Right? So I will now look at 9 and say, oh, 9 has nothing left to explore because it only had one neighbor 8 from which it came, so that's already marked. So I will go back to 8, but 8 has nothing more to do because 5 and 7 were also marked. So, but 8 was triggered by 7, so I will go back to 7, right? 7 was triggered by 5, so I will go back to 5. 5 was triggered by 3, so I will go back to 3. 3 was triggered by 4, so I have come back to the empty stack, right? So I have nothing on the suspended list. I have also now, like before, from 4 I explored 0 and 1, but indirectly through this sequence I have already explored 7. So 4 also has nothing to be done. So I say 4 is terminated and I quit. Right? So this was how depth first search worked. Right? So in a way, you can imagine depth first search the way you kind of browse on the internet, right? You start reading something interesting and then you click on a link because you see it's interesting and you follow that. And before you know where you are, you had started reading something and you are somewhere far away. So then you have to go back, follow back these links and go back to where you started and continue, right? So that's more or less what depth first search is doing. So you find the first interesting vertex and you go there. You keep this in suspension, go there. Then find the first interesting vertex, go there, and so on. So depth first search finds these long paths. Like we said, the path it found from 4 to 7 was, it said that 4 triggered 3. Okay, so we could have kept this parent information, which we did not. But for everything which is marked as visited, like in the breadth first search, you could also mark in depth first search why it was marked visited, right? So you could keep this parent information. So we said that 4 marked 3, 3 marked 5, 5 marked 6, then came back, and then 5 marked 7. So we found this long path 4 to 3 to 5 to 7. If we had kept the parent information, it would have said parent of 7 is 5, parent of 5 is 3, and parent of 3 is 4. But this is obviously not the shortest path, right? So it doesn't do what breadth first search does in terms of shortest paths. So it seems a bit strange that we use this kind of indirect way of exploring when we have something which seems to be a better one, namely breadth first search. It turns out that actually depth first search is very useful for other things. Right? So one thing that we can do in depth first search is keep track of how we visit these vertices. Right? So what I can do, we will do it formally next time, but informally I can say that we keep a counter. Right? So we say that when the counter is 0, we entered 4. When the counter was 0, we entered 4, and from 4, we entered the vertex 0. So at this point, the counter became 1. From 0, we entered 2, entered 1. So at this point, the counter became 2. From 1, we entered this. So at this point, the counter became 3. Now we finished because there was nothing to do at 2. So we finished 2 at the counter was 4. When we finished 1, the counter is 5. When we finished 0, the counter is 6. Right? And now we have come back to 4. So now from 4, when we explore 7, the 3, the counter is 7, and so on. Right? So in this way, we can keep a counter incremented every time we enter a vertex for the first time and record it against that vertex as the incoming number of that vertex. And then every time we finish processing a vertex, that is, all its edges have been visited, then all its neighbors have been visited, then we mark it saying that this is when we finished it. So we started one vertex 1 at counter 2, we finished vertex 1 at counter 5. We started vertex 0 at counter 1, we finished vertex 0 at counter 6. So notice that the counter value tells you something. It tells you that 1 was visited after 0 because 1 started at 2, 0 started at 1. and 0 finished after 1 because 1 finished at 5 and 0 finished at 6. So this DFS numbering is very useful, and we can use it to find many interesting things. So there are some things that we talked about last time as problems on graphs. We talked about coloring, we talked about matching and so on. But sometimes you also want to find special vertices, right? So for example, supposing there's a critical vertex in your graph. So imagine an electrical network, right? Supposing there is one power station which is very critical, that if anything happens to this power station, then the entire electrical network will get divided into two disconnected portions. So this is called a cut vertex, or sometimes called an articulation point. So in this network, for example, if this is an airline network, right, and we are imagining that some airport is unavailable because of bad weather. So supposing there is a cyclone, right? So supposing vertex 4, the airport at city number 4 is knocked out of service because of a cyclone. Then you can see that there is no way to get from these vertices to these vertices, right? So we can still travel between 3 to 9, we can still travel between 0, 1, 2, but we can't travel from the 0, 1, 2 section to this. So now the graph has become disconnected. So how would we discover that 4 is such a vertex, right? For instance, 3 is not such a vertex. If I remove 3, the graph still remains connected by this outer path, right? So the 3 is not a, right? So if I remove 3, there is no problem. If I remove 5 also, there is no problem. Right? I can still go from 4 to 6 this way, and I can come to these this way. So which are the articulation points or cut vertices? You can discover that using DFS numbering. A related thing is, this is for vertices. A related question is for edges. So are there edges which are critical for me? If there is a route which I cannot follow, will that disconnect things for me? Right? So now you can see that this route is okay, because it's not a critical route, because if I cannot go from 4 to 3 directly, I can still follow an indirect path and go from 4 to 3. But again, if I knock off this one, right, if I knock off the route from 4 to 0, then it turns out that 0 to 1, 2 is disconnected from the rest of the network. Right? So this is called a bridge. So these kinds of properties of graphs, these cut vertices, bridges, and many other interesting things can be discovered as a byproduct of depth-first search. So you do a depth-first search, then you do this DFS numbering, which we will describe in a later class. And using this DFS numbering, you can actually find out interesting properties of the graph. So that's why depth-first search, though it does not find shortest paths, it finds out interesting structure within a graph. Okay, so to summarize, DFS is a different strategy from breadth-first search. It's another systematic strategy to explore a graph. So what we do is we start with the vertex, suspend it, go to an unvisited neighbor, suspend it, go to an unvisited neighbor, and so on. And in order to keep track of these suspended vertices and how to resume them in a systematic way, we use a stack. So we use this last in, first out data structure in order to keep track of how to resume vertices when we come back from a terminated computation. And we saw that, although not in detail, just informally, we saw that we can, if we keep track of the sequence in which we visit vertices, when we finish, when we enter and when we finish, we get this DFS numbering. And with this DFS numbering, we can actually uncover some structural properties of graphs, which are quite interesting.